The next thing we're going to do is look into player health. So obviously we just created a slider to represent the health. We now want to actually implement that.
So we have this health UI, and so the next component to this game that we want to have is we want to have the player have health that is able to be taken away and is able to also interact with our UI that we just created. We also want to have the enemy have the ability to attack the player and thus take that health away. And then from there, we're going to reverse the roles. We're going to give the enemy some health and then give the player the ability to take that health away. So what we're going to do to start is we are going to go to the scripts folder, and we are going to locate the player folder, and we should find a script called player health. So we're going to take that, and we are going to click and drag that onto the player game object in our hierarchy. So we'll drop it there, and if we click on the player, we scroll down, we should see player health script as a component. Also, we are currently still in this view where we're really zoomed out and we're focused on the canvas and all that stuff. So why don't we take a second, we'll come out of 2D view here by just, again, clicking on the 2D button right there, bringing us out of that 2D mode. And then if we want to get to the player quickly, we can just double click on the player's name in the hierarchy. We'll zoom us right in there. Just sort of brings us back to where we were previously. We now have the player health script on the player. So we're going to open it up and take a look at it. Before we do, be sure to save your scene. And let's go ahead and pop this open. All right, player health. So we start off with our player health with a whole bunch of variables. And so let's just step through and see what each of these are. So the first variable here is our starting health, which is a public integer, which dictates how much health the player has when the level first starts. Next, we have an integer for current health, which is how much health the player will have after they've been damaged or just at any given point in the game. We have this health slider, which is a slider game object, which is the reference to that slider UI element we created earlier. Now, a good note right here, we're accessing slider, right, which is part of the new UI. In order to access this, we need to include using UnityEngine.UI. If you don't have that line of code at the top, using UnityEngine.UI, you're not going to be able to use text, images, sliders, any of the new UI components. So just keep in mind you have to have that. After the slider, we then have a public image damage image, which is, again, a reference to that damage image item we created. We have an audio, which is our death clip. So unlike our hurt clip, the death clip is going to be what's called a one-shot audio, where we basically are saying, we're not going to play the hurt sound anymore. This is the sound the player makes when the player loses the game. We have a public float flash speed, which is how quickly the damaged image flashes up on the screen. And then we have flash color, which we have set to 100.1, which means completely red and a tenth of the way completely opaque. So it's mostly transparent and red. Next, we have some private variables. The first is animator anim, which again is a reference to our animator components. We have a reference to our audio source, which is we call player audio. We have a reference to the player movement script. So this is the first time we've seen this. We've created a reference to another script that we've already written. You all remember writing player movement earlier today, so now we are actually getting a reference to that script that is on the player so that we can prevent the player from running around once the player is dead. We have to have a reference to it to do that. So we're going to be seeing some script interactivity there. We have two Boolean values. One is dead, which will determine whether or not the player is dead. And the other is damaged, which will allow us to know whether or not the player has taken damage. The awake function here is going to be fairly similar to what we've seen before. We're starting by getting a reference component to our animator. We're then getting a reference to our audio source. Player audio equals get component audio source. This is slightly new, so here we're doing player movement equals get component player movement. And you'll see to get the component of the script we've created, we just use the name of that script. Script is called player movement. I want a reference to it, so I get component player movement. Again, we have some commented out code. We'll revisit this script and re-enable that later. And then we're gonna say our current health is equal to our starting health. You'll recall awake gets called right at the beginning when the game first starts up, so we're just gonna set our current health to its max value right there. Update method. And our update method is really simple. Update is simply concerning itself with whether or not we are flashing that red damaged image, right? And so basically what this function is saying is, hey, if we are damaged, if damage has been taken, what we're going to do is we are going to set this image to our flash color, which you'll recall is red. with a 10% opacity. So that's going to happen immediately. It's going to flash this red. Otherwise, if we're not damaged, okay, what we're concerned with is fading the damaged image away. So it flashes red, and then we're going to fade it back to transparent. And we do that, again, using lerp. Before, we use vector3.lerp with like the player's movement. So now what we're doing is we're doing a color.lerp, which is the exact same concept. We're moving from one to another, right? But instead of vector threes, we're doing color. So we're doing color.lerp, and we're passing in the current color of our damage image, and then we're passing in the color that we would like, which is completely clear, completely invisible, and then we have our flash speed times time.delta time. Very much like the smoothing that we had on the camera, right, as it would follow the player around. Here we're just smoothing or transitioning from the color that it is all the way to transparent. And then finally, at the end of every update cycle, we're setting damage equal to false. What that basically means is the moment we take damage, we're then going to set damage back to false after showing that damage image. In the next bit here, what we have is a function called takeDamage. Now, this function is also unique because it is a public function. As such, what this means is other scripts and other components can call this function. takeDamage is a special function in this script in that it's not called in this script. Other stuff calls this function, right? So when the enemies attack the player, they call the takeDamage function. And so again, that script interactivity is important. It has to be public or else this isn't going to work. The one parameter or argument for this function is intAmount, which is how much damage the player has taken. Next, what we're going to do is we want to ensure that the player has, the player flashes that red image. So we do that by saying damaged equals true. We detract the amount of damage from our current health. We do that using a little shorthand here by saying current health minus equals amount. What that little shorthand means is we're going to say take the current health, remove the amount of damage, and then put that back into current health. So it just basically reduces by that amount. We are then going to take our current health and pass it into the value of our slider. And so we see the slider slowly shrink as the player takes more damage. Next, we're going to play our audio. And if we recall, we set up an audio source on the player in Unity, and we gave it that player hurt audio. So basically, every time the player takes damage, they're going to play that hurt audio. All right, and then finally, we're going to say, hey, by the way, so the player's hurt and all that stuff. Is the player dead? Right? And so what we're going to do is we're going to say, hey, if their current health is now below or equal to zero, and they're not already dead, that's what that and not is dead, make them dead, right? Because there's no sense in making them dead if they're already dead. And if that happens, we're going to call a new function called death. Death is a function that is in this script. It's not like built into Unity or anything like that. It's actually the very next function we're going to look at. So basically, if the health drops below zero, we're going to call this death function. And here's what the death function does. So the first thing the death function does is sets is dead equal to true, saying, yeah, okay, player is dead. Next, we've got some disabled code. We'll come back to that. Next, we say anim.setTriggerDie. Remember when we did the animator controller, right, in the animator window, and we had that second parameter, which was die, which was a trigger? This is where we play that animation. So we say setTriggerDie, and the character plays their death animation. We then set the audio clip of the audio source to this death clip, right? And then we play that sound, the sound the player makes when they lose the game. And then finally, here's where we access that script, the player movement script that we added as a component. We say player movement.enabled equals false, which basically means no more movement. That script component on the object gets disabled, stops reading our inputs, player stops moving. And so this is that script in its entirety. So let's go ahead, we'll close this down here, and now we're going to return to the Unity editor. And again, I reiterate, make sure that if you click on the player in the hierarchy that you see the player health component at the very bottom, which will let you know that you put that script onto the right game object. So now that we are, we're back here and we have this player health script component on the player game object, what we're gonna do is we are going to start filling in some of these values. So we can see starting health is 100, that's fine, that's what we want. Current health is zero, that again doesn't matter, that's gonna be set in the awake function. But here we have this health slider property, right? And it's currently empty. And this is where we establish that link between the UI that we created and the script that we've just added. So if we look in the hierarchy, we see the HUD canvas, which we expand, and then the health UI, which we expand. And right here, we have our health slider. So if we were to take this health slider and just click and drag and drop it into the health slider property, that will link the health slider UI component with this player health script. So now we can update the health via the slider. Next, we have this damage image. So again, I'm going to come up and I'm going to grab my damage image from the HUD, and I'm going to click and drag down into the damage image property in the script. And then finally, I have this death clip, which currently says none. I'm going to click the circle select here, and I'm going to look for player death. And I'm just going to double click, and we'll see that that gets added there. So the next thing I want to do now, so the player has health. The health is interfaced with our UI system. So as the player loses health, the UI system reacts, and all that's done. Now what we want to do is we want to give the enemies the ability to actually attack the player, and thus we can see that this all works and see the interactivity of our game objects. So what we want to do is we want to look in the scripts folder, and we want to locate the enemy scripts folder, and we're going to locate the enemy attack script. And what we want to do is we want to click and drag that onto the Zom Bunny. Again, when we select the Zom Bunny afterwards, we should see enemy attack at the bottom there. Let's go ahead and open up enemy attack. So enemy attack. So a lot of this stuff is going to be very familiar to you by now. But again, we're going to start with a few public variables. The first public variable we're interested in is a public float time between attacks, which is 0.5. It basically is the amount of time between each of the attacks. And then we also have a public integer, which is the attack damage. So how much damage does each of these attacks do to the player? Then we have our private variables, and again, these are very similar. We have an animator variable named anim, which is going to store a reference to our animator component. We have a game object parameter, which is going to be the player. So again, the enemy will be able to attack the player, so it needs to have some reference to that player. We have a reference to the player health script. So now this is kind of new. We have the enemy referencing a script that we have created that's on a different game object. So the player has a player health script, and the enemy has a reference to it so that the enemy can then damage the player. We have a bit of code that's commented out, and then we have a Boolean value player in range. This will be set to true whenever the player gets close enough for the enemy to attack. It'll be set back to false when the player gets too far away. And then finally, we have float timer, and timer is a variable that we're going to use to keep everything in sync, to make sure that the enemy is not attacking too fast, not too slow. In our awake function, again, we're going to be setting up a lot of our stuff. So we're doing gameObject.findGameObject with tag player, which again is going to locate the player for us and store that reference locally. We do this in the awake method, and then we store it so that we don't have to do it every frame or every time we need it. This is a fairly inefficient call, so we really want to limit the number of times we do that. So by doing it once in the awake function and storing it, we're greatly improving the performance of our games and project. Then we use that player object that we just found, and we say player.getComponentPlayerHealth, thus pulling the player health script off of that player, and again, storing a reference to it. Now with that reference, we have the ability to call that public function takeDamage we saw previously. And then finally, we do getComponentAnimator to set up a reference to our animator component. Now, remember how we created the sphere collider on the enemy that was a trigger? I talked about how triggers are not used for in-scene effects, and Will was talking about how we use these for detecting collisions, stuff like that, kind of behind the scenes. If we have a trigger on an object, and another object comes in collision with that, it doesn't react physically because it's a trigger. Instead, it calls a function. And if we have a function in a script, that function runs. The function's called onTriggerEnter, and it gets called whenever anything goes into a trigger. So here we have void onTriggerEnter, and then inside parentheses we have collider_other. Other is whatever it is that collided with this collider. If I'm the enemy and something collided with me, chances are other is the player. And so now I know where that is. And so the very next line is me making sure that it's the player, because we don't want to be able to attack a sofa. We want to only attack the player. And as such, we want to ensure what it is we are attacking. So we're going to say if other.gameObject double equals player. And that double equals is an equality operator. This basically says, are these the same thing? So if what we collided with is the player, cool. Okay, we can attack it. If that's true, then we set player in range to true. Now there's an inverse version of that function called onTriggerExit. It tells us that something was in the trigger and it has now gone away. All right, that's just the complete opposite. So again, what we're gonna say is, hey, was the thing that left the trigger the player? If it was, the player is no longer in range. So we set that to false. Okay, so we just use this trigger to say, hey, they're close enough, no, they're not close enough anymore. Hey, they're close enough, no, they're not close enough anymore. This isn't actually the attacking part. This is just how we determine whether or not we're close enough. The actual attacking happens in the update. So in the update method, the first thing we do is we determine how much time has occurred. So we start accumulating this time inside the variable timer. So every time update runs, timer gets a little bit bigger and a little bit bigger, and it represents how much time has passed. Then we're going to say, hey, if the timer is greater than the time between attacks, so it's been long enough between attacks, and the player is close enough, we're going to attack the player, right? And you can see that we call the function attack. Then finally, we'll look at attack here in a second. Then finally, we say, if the player's health is less than or equal to zero, that means the player died, right? Our attack killed it and the player died. So we're gonna do anim.set trigger player dead, which, as we recall, will transition us from the moving state to the idle state. Player is dead, so now we all just get to sit around and go, well, that was fun, now what? And so that's how we stop chasing the player around. So if the timer is greater than the time between attacks and the player is in range, we call this attack function, and this is what the attack function looks like. The first thing we do is we reset timer. We're now attacking, so time is set back to zero. And then we are going to say, hey, if the player is alive, player health dot current health is greater than zero, let's take some of that away. So we say player health dot take damage, and we pass in however much damage this enemy does. And so then the player is gonna manage the rest of that. And if that happens to kill them, the rest of the update will run and we'll transition into the idle state. And so that is our enemy attack. And so once we've taken a look at that, be sure to save our scene to sort of wrap up what we've just done here. Why not test this? So let's pop back over to Unity. Will, go ahead and get eaten. Oh, and he's taking damage. And we see the health slider being reduced in size. We see the screen flashing slightly. And man, that zombunny's relentless. I don't think he wants to give you hugs.
The damage image there is quite faint, but we can play around with that with the flash color public variable on player health on the player. So if we wanted to make that more apparent, then we could crank it up a little bit and it would flash a bit more harshly like that.
Again, he achieved this just now by increasing the alpha of the color on the player health script, right? So obviously the higher the alpha, the stronger the effect, and so on and so forth.